everyone. I'm João Ribeiro, and I'm going to present a paper on the connection of dynamic temporal continuities in video games. This research takes into account video game and media theory. It presents a chronology of schools of thought and an analysis of the application of the theory to zoo case studies to determine the motives behind players' actions over time. We cannot match the duration of a narrative to that of the story, since people cannot assess the length of the narrative. The story is the end-shaped content and contains events, characters, and settings. A narrative is a sequence of logically and chronologically related events, come together by a recurrent focus on one or more individuals in whom the reader becomes interested. Besides dealing both with the time of the story and the narrative, narrative media are also spatial. And text is any communication that temporally controls its reception by the audience, as in media which has set times for interaction or exposition, like films, which are not interactive and have set running times. Brannigan's proposal consists of an outline of the core elements of a narrative schema laid out like an hexagon. He suggests that a narrative can be constructed and deconstructed by moving through an hexagon to create patterns at levels of action, scene, episode, sequence, etc. Espinarzev explains that players' interactions contribute to the realization of temporality in video games. Players' understanding of time as they experience depends on the actions undertaken by the player in cooperation with the developments issued by the rule-based space. Spatial understanding is the fabric by which the player comprehends time. That connection tries to consolidate the player's comprehension of the game's status, the current configuration of a game's rules after input of the player. Such spatial and temporal understanding provides context for the narrative. Zagawa and Mateus define temporal frame as a group of events in conjunction with the temporality caused by links among events. The authors suggest four shared temporal frames: real-world time, game-world time, coordination time, and fictive time. Jasper Drew differentiates fictional time from event time, defining the first as time the player takes to play, and the second as time taken in the game world. Julian Gonzalez and Hugo Bando state that video games can be studied and classified as types of dynamic tasks. Tasks are problems that players have to solve. Clara Fernandez Vara proposes a model to be applied to adventure games and is intended to consider how time serves as performance in the story and the game. The model consists of three components: player time, simulation time, and story time. The way a video game regulates time is influenced by the reference frame used in the calculation of how time passes, that is, the player in real time, the simulation in cycle-driven time, or the story in event time. Chronology is a dimension that emphasizes players' awareness of the changes in a sequence of events with objective time management in mind. Primarily general purpose, game time distinguishes itself by its plasticity, navigability, and potential. Game time is restrictive and demands repetition. Hansen and Valentin propose considering time as an essential factor in video games, in which urgency is a motivator for the why and the when of player action. The goal of this research was to examine temporal continuities and players' understanding of them, to describe time in the experience of video games, and to provide a model for the analysis of time. So we selected two games representing two different genres, played by a small group of students, 10 students, in a classroom setting for about half an hour each game. And the students completed a questionnaire for each game as well. As for games, we selected Brawlhalla and Bury Me My Love. Brawlhalla is a competitive online fighting video game and Bury Me, Meanwhile is a narrative-based game centered around a Syrian refugee. As for data collection, we started by having the students play the game on a computer. We verified that they were comfortable with the system. They played one at a time, with the others waiting outside the room. We explained the concepts of both story and narrative, and then we distributed a questionnaire with four types of questions: integer questions, ranking, open-ended, and Boolean questions. The questions related to their understanding of narrative time and story time. Players' control of time was measured through questions on perception. Using keywords, they defined the events leading to input actions, and we asked them to explain why they use such input actions. They also identified when the games felt, or the narratives of the games were completed to them. As for results, most players differentiate between the temporal point of the narrative and the story. Most agree that the overall narrative was larger than the story of the game. Some read "War in Valhalla" for a minute, but claim to have been exposed to the story for 15 minutes, although the war is the only part of the game that contains story, not narrative. And results are unclear, improving players' understanding that time differs between real and story time. As far as video games as text types, the results are inconsistent in showing us whether video games are understood as text types. Players answered that they did not feel in total control of time in both games, and 60% of players in both games answered that they felt like they had agency over the temporal order, but they are split on who is in control of time, themselves or the video game. Regarding event sequences, on Valhalla, players describe the need to attack and defend as their primary motivation. On Bury Me, My Love, they said the need to answer Nur and advance the story was the main incentive. This meets Witcher's expectations that time can be studied through distinct dynamic tasks, and they also stated that the need to understand game mechanics and advance the plot were their reasons for action. When it comes to narrative closure, on Bury Me, My Love, most players said the narrative was never closed, while in Brawlhalla, most players stated that the narrative was only closed after finishing the first round, returning to the character selection screen, and starting a new game. From this, we conclude that solving of narrative frictions brings about narrative closure, and that things like rounds, levels, episodes, and other mechanics of progression can be separators of narrative moments. As for other results, on Bury Me, My Love, players' main challenge was answering, stating some lack of agency in the game. And on Brawlhalla, a player's main challenge was keeping their character alive and defeating their opponent. And most players reported more immersion in the game of Bury Me, My Love. We think that this might have happened due to their feeling that the narrative on that game never ended because they only played it for 30 minutes. As far as conclusion go, players are split on who is in control of time in video games. Time can be analyzed via distinct dynamic tasks and narrative cycles. Players identify their inputs, which can be used to map agency and the passage of time, since distinct motives for input indicate temporal progression. And players' resource awareness and their application represent both goals and tasks, which leads to the resolution of narrative friction. As for future recommendations, research on video games as text types must be more diverse in population, time of session, and number of objects studied. We need to study players' understanding that time passes separately in real time and event time. Study why urgency motivates why and when players act, and we also need to study the variances that arise from different emotional, cultural, and ethnic specificities of users. That is it. Thank you.
Vamos ver a apresentação. E segundo a nossa informação, nós temos presente o João Ribeiro.
Sim, bom dia.
Bom dia, João. Muito obrigado por uma excelente apresentação sobre um tema que é novo para muitos e é um tema que é emergente. Eu tenho uma questão a colocá-lo que é sobre qual é o posicionamento da narrativa segundo os vários discursos culturais. Ou seja, vocês focaram-se em alguns exemplos. Como é que a conotação cultural consegue alterar esse modo narrativo e como é que ele vai influenciar a própria construção do jogo?
Eu acho que a questão mais cultural na sua relação com a narrativa efetivamente é um assunto que tem que ser estudado com mais detalhe e com uma população bastante diversa. Portanto, eu apenas tive a oportunidade, ou nós tivemos a oportunidade de abordar uma amostra de jogadores portugueses. E portanto, a associação, ou a interpretação da história, e das mecânicas de jogo que fazem com que a narrativa, emerja, no espaço imaginado do jogador, está sempre relacionado com o seu contexto cultural, obviamente, e existem certas mecânicas, certos plot points, que estão relacionados, também, ou que se relacionam e que derivam significado de acordo com a nossa cultura, obviamente. Se pensarmos, por exemplo, numa cultura ocidental, ocidental não, oriental, podemos perceber que a interpretação de questões como paleta cromática, questões de prosémia entre personagens, a relação com certos elementos da história será diferente, ou a nossa expectativa é que será diferente, porque a cultura também é bastante diferente. E a relação com o design do espaço mediado também é bastante diferente. E portanto, eu não consigo prever quais serão essas diferenças, mas imagino que sim, que existam diferenças na narrativa, dependendo de questões culturais. Não sei se respondi muito bem à sua questão.
Sim, era nesse sentido que se dirigiu a pergunta que eu coloquei. Porque mesmo a nível dos jogos online, dos jogos em múltiplas plataformas, eles têm um mercado muito amplo. Pode ser um mercado que é com características globais ou características localizadas num determinado país ou numa determinada região. E para quem concebe um jogo, há determinadas matrizes culturais que vão afetar a narrativa da forma como vai construir. Era nesse sentido.